Good morning, Austin, and welcome to another mudslinging episode of the Atheist Experience, the show that makes WCW Nitro look like Teletubbies. We are here. We are live. It is May 21st, I believe,
yeah, that's right.
2000 CE. And welcome again. I am your host for this morning's show, Martin Wagner. Ordinarily, as regular viewers might know, I'm the co-host, but Jeff is a little under the weather this morning, unfortunately, so sorry about that. I talked to him yesterday, and he was like this, so it didn't really sound good. So, and Ray is also kind of down in a funk. So
must be the influence of the Almighty God.
That's it. Yeah.
To prevent the show from going.
That's right. He's struck down two of ours. All right. Anyway, here we are. Hopefully, Vic has remembered to start the tape. okay. This show is sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. The ACA has weekly meetings at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop at 10:30 a.m. Right after this broadcast. The Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop is located on 5th Street between Guadalupe and Lavaca. And those are the streets, right? And we have those meetings, as I said, every Sunday, except for the first Sunday of each month when we have our lecture series at Furr's Cafeteria in North Cross Mall. Our lecture series, I don't have the date right in front of me, but the next one will be first Sunday in June. And I've forgotten the name of the speaker, but I remember that the subject matter of the next lecture is going to be dealing with religious family members, extremely religious family, how to talk to them.
Larry Bronstein.
Thank you very much. The Bagel Shop meetings are open to atheists, agnostics, ACA members, atheist-friendly people. It's a just big social gathering. If you're an unbeliever and you feel you don't know anyone else who's an unbeliever and feel a little marginalized and cut off and don't know who to share your views with and you want to meet some more atheists, come on down. Love to talk to you. To find out more about ACA, you can hit our website at www.atheist-community.org, or you can call our voicemail at 371-2911. This show can also be seen on the web at spring.net. The fellow who maintains the site phoned us up and he said he's not actually doing a streaming video thing because we're just, you know, guys sitting at a table talking, and that doesn't exactly make for exciting television. So
doesn't I think he has all the bandwidth.
Right, yeah, it's not worth it. So he just has, I think, intermittent still images, but there is full streaming audio.
And I have it on good authority that it was working last week.
That's right. Joe Zemecki phoned us from New Jersey. Joe used to be the co-host of this show and called us up and said that he was watching us on spring.net right that very minute. So we do know it works.
How about that?
Yeah. If you're calling long distance, also please let our phone screener know that. We'll be sure and get you on the air. We pronto take your call right away and help you out. Thanks for joining us this morning. And thanks to Russell Glasser, our guest again this week.
Well, it's nice to be here.
Yeah. Great to have you. Russell was on the show last week and began what is looking like it's going to be a multi-part presentation that he has put together on this oxymoronic, bizarre thing called creation science. And last week it really brought the creationists out of the woodworks on the phone, didn't
really
it?
Really heated up last week. In fact, some of them did a great job of proving my point, which I was grateful for.
Yeah, it was a very interesting experience, and particularly for me. I got to be honest with you. I've been an atheist for a while, and I've had occasional conversations with Christians about things. But this is the first time that I've ever really sort of firsthand experienced the dyed-in-the-wool creationist who will actually, with a perfectly straight face, make arguments like all fossils are fake, and science is actually this big sort of conspiracy that's been put together to, you know, discredit Christianity.
Well, it's not surprising that you haven't had to have too much contact with them because they're not really typical Christians.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, fortunately.
As much as I dislike religion, I have to state that most people are a lot more sane than
I'm suddenly like, boy, yeah, that was, I heard myself through the speakers, like, all right, anyway, since we don't have a co-host, I'm going to do the news thing right quick, and then we're going to go to Russell so that he can continue his creation science presentation. So let's start with the news for this morning, beginning with science news. Scientists paint a new picture of the adult brain. Here's something interesting, new brain research. Scientists are learning how experience can reshape and reorganize people's brains, not just as children, but even after they've grown up. The realization that the brain is not fixed at puberty, as previously thought, could be good news for victims of injury, stroke, or disease. Quote, it may be possible in the future to bypass a damaged brain area. Dr. Mike Ridding, a neuroscientist at Australia's Adelaide University, now puffed us. Sorry, Monty Python reference. Wrote in April's Journal of Experimental Brain Research. The ability to regenerate or grow nerve cells in the brain also could help people who sustain damage to other parts of their central nervous systems, including the spinal cord. And it goes on in some detail to talk about, you know, the, like, various brain research that has been done over the years. You know, for example, how blind people who read Braille, the part of their brain that, that receives tactile sensations is actually larger. It's more developed to compensate for no sight.
Interesting.
And that's actually something that's kind of been known for a while, and now they're looking at other ways that brain cells can either be regenerated or just how the brain works, and ultimately the hope is that if they understand the mechanisms of this, it could possibly lead to effective treatments for Parkinson's and Huntington's and Alzheimer's and all these degenerative brain diseases.
So there's still hope for Michael J. Fox, huh?
Potentially, yeah. More hope than ever. And particularly, and not just for him, but for, face it, a lot of people, because our generation is, as compared to our parents' generation, more of us are likely to live, to our dotage, to their, 75 and up than, previous. I mean, people are, life expectancy is increasing.
Would that be due to religion or science, Martin?
Gee, I want to take a big guess. And just take a big whopping guess on that one. So as the population ages, though, we are just going to have more and more people suffering the debilitating effects of aging, the body breaking down. And so this is just all in part and parcel of fucking that. And science marches on, which is always a happy thing we like to hear. In other cool science news, this is something that was on CNN. Actually, Jeff even posted this to the group. It was so wild. There has been a dig in the Gobi Desert, a paleontological suffering fuckatash. I actually got that out. Dig in the Gobi Desert, and they've uncovered some dinosaur bones, two of which are two dinosaurs like duking it out, actually fighting, and they were buried like this. So a daily. This is from CNN.com. A deadly velociraptor thrusts a claw into the neck of a heavily armored protoceratops, which has bitten the arm of its adversary. Locked in mortal combat for 80 million years, the fossilized foes are considered among the greatest dinosaur finds ever. And there's a really cool photo of them, which is like postage stamp size, so there's no point in trying to show it to you on the air. But of course, our helpful creationist friends will tell us it's all just a fake anyway.
Okay.
But the two lead a stampede of Mongolian dinosaurs invading New York for a long prehistoric summer and shaking the foundations of natural history. The rare finds, which include nesting parents, embryos, and hatchlings, have reshaped scientific theories on the behavior and evolution of the Cretaceous creatures. The remarkable centerpiece of the exhibition, the skeletons of two dinosaurs preserved in a deadly fight, has been designated a national treasure of Mongolia. Gobi Deserts in Mongolia. The velociraptor, a fierce carnivore about the size of a coyote, embeds a huge hind talon in the crouching protoceratops. With its right arm, the velociraptor grips the shielded head of its foe. This is great stuff. The plant-eating protoceratops, a cousin of the triceratops, seems to have used its powerful jaws to break the velociraptor's left arm. It's wild. Collapsing sand dune may have buried the two combatants, according to the museum. And it goes on to discuss in some detail about how a lot of these finds on this dig seem to reinforce the more recent theories that dinosaurs have a closer evolutionary link to birds than reptiles in some cases. That's all very fascinating. And anyway, I'll just for the hell of it, I'll read this URL right quickly so to anyone who's on the ball, because you can go to cnn.com/2000/nature/05/17/fighting.dinos. And that's all you're going to get from me. I'm not going to repeat it. But that's just where the article is, and they got the photos there, and it's more detailed. So you can check it out. A lot of fun. So more theories about the and discoveries about the early Earth. What do you know? And I bet you that these little suckers are more than 6,000 years old, but find that out.
Suspect that, yeah.
And for our final news article of the morning, it's our amusing Christian faux pas of the week. I love this one. Hundreds of videotapes about the life of Jesus that landed on the doorsteps of Palm Beach County residents are back in the mail.
I didn't know they had videos back then.
Yes. Back in the mail marked return to sender. Yeah, I guess it was some sort of VH1 Where Are They Now thing or something. Anyway, some residents, many of them Jewish, were so angry about the unsolicited mailing that they bundled bricks with the tapes to increase the return shipping charges. Quote, we've never had as many people call or as many returns in the 22 years I've worked here, Cecile Sasso of the U.S. Postal Service in West Palm Beach said. About 400,000 tapes were mailed to Palm Beach County residents during the week of Passover and Easter by the evangelical group Campus Crusade for Christ. The Orlando-based group spent $1.2 million on the project. It's just, I mean, they can get their hands on that money and just piss it away. Clergy involved in the mailing.
It all comes from their parishioners.
Exactly.
So,
anyway,
it's not their problem.
Clergy involved in the mailing said they didn't mean to offend. Well, of course, they didn't mean to offend, but they went ahead and did it anyway. All right, so that's the news for this Sunday.
I have something else that's sort of news-like to mention.
Go right ahead.
You've heard about the movie Battlefield Earth, based on the book written by L. Ron Hubbard, who is the founder of Scientology, and starring John Travolta, who is one of the most well-known members of Scientology.
And these wacky sort of dreadlocks with a thing up his nose.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, I have not seen this. I have read a lot of reviews, and they're unbelievably bad. Mm-hmm. But what was most interesting to me was on the Child Care Action Project website, www.capalert.com, where this fundamentalist reviews all the new movies coming out and talks about how evil and immoral they are. In all the time I've been reading this website, I've never known him to actually comment on how good a movie is, only on how degenerate it is,
he doesn't do
dangerous
a plot synopsis.
To our
he just sits there like with a checklist and itemizes dirty words, boob shots, stuff like that. You know, he doesn't really talk about the movies as movies.
Right. Well, the this movie apparently was so bad that the guy at Child Care Action Project was critiquing holes in the plot for the first time I've ever seen.
Yeah. Now, when a movie is so bad that it makes a fundamentalist notice logic flaws, that's a bad movie. Okay. So anyway. Welcome back, Russell.
Oh, and thank you.
You have the continuation of your compelling feature on creation science for us.
You got it.
Got so many riled up calls. And you know what we didn't do before we went on the air because we had all this last minute panic? We didn't do a phone check. So I'm just going to take it on faith that the phones are going to work and the number to call us and talk to us or yell at us or do whatever
Which
you like is
hopefully will pop up
472-2255. And this is a fun show. We entertain calls from both atheists and theists, so please call and ask us any questions you like. Now, it's not my style, to flat call people morons. But that doesn't mean, if you mount a moronic argument, you're going to get off easy just because Jeff is ill today. So don't get any wrong ideas. But we're here, so call us and talk to us. And let's go over to Russell for the continuation of his series.
Okay, well, so today I'm going to be finishing the discussion that I started on creation science last week. And just like last week, if you want to look up some of the references that I've provided with this, you can go to my website, which is http://rglasser.home.texas.net/atheism. So let me recap our last discussion real briefly. Mm-hmm. The first thing I talked about was the fact that creationism, which is, of course, the belief that the Earth was created 6,000 years ago in one literal week, isn't really a science. Contrary to some popular belief, evolution, of course, is a well-established scientific principle that doesn't experience any opposition from mainstream scientists. It's only portrayed as a controversy by a very small group of fundamentalists. Then I started to talk about some of the underhanded tactics that creationists use, such as using misquotations from Darwin about the eye, for instance, relying on outdated or obsolete science, or just making up plain old false claims like no transitional fossils have ever been found. And that's what really brought some of the creationists out to call us.
Yeah.
We had some callers who did a great job of proving my point, like I said. They started arguing that all the fossils in museums, well, they must be fake.
Yeah.
I remember Arlo mentioning some of the fossils that he saw at the Smithsonian Institute last year, and the caller apparently was reduced to arguing that these, well, must have been designed by artists.
Yeah.
It's so typical of the kind of ad hoc explanations that creationists use to prove their point. Forget about truth as long as we can convince people to take the Bible literally, right?
Yeah. Well, it's so many of the... Well, first off, I think a lot of those claims are based upon just a very basic, utter misunderstanding of like the whole concept of a transitional form.
That is true.
What they don't understand is that every life form that exists is a transitional form. They're working on the presupposition that this whole universe is here for us.
Right. You know, we keep hearing calls like, "Well, why aren't people still evolving?"
Yeah, and that's the whole point. They have that life doesn't like. There's not an end result that it's
right.
All, you know. But of course, that's also at the root of the design argument. You know, when you if something's designed, it's designed to like be a thing or
right.
do a thing. And so for people who think that the universe must have been designed by some godly designer, they think that, you know, life forms must have been designed to be something and not something else. So if we evolved to get to here, and if we were something
we
else before,
done.
There must have been like a thing in between, you know, the whole missing link fallacy.
Right.
And so they don't understand, no, evolution is this ongoing process. It's going to go on and going to go on. If there are human beings on this planet 150 million years from now, they're not going to be a whole lot like us.
You know, well, they're probably going to be somewhat like us.
Yeah, somewhat like us.
Completely.
But there will, you know, probably be some differences genetically and what have you. Because that's a long period of time.
That's true.
You know, just as...
Certainly a lot longer than one person's lifetime, which is the framework in which we try to view evolution.
Right. So, you know, when they look for transitional form, they're looking for something that's like, you know, a man's torso, upper torso, and a fish's lower torso. And, they want to see something that's kind of half this and half that. So
right.
that fits their understanding of what it is, but it's...
Yeah, there's like, how come we don't have a half zebra, half pig?
Yeah.
And the answer is that pigs don't turn into zebras. It's just that they're both mammals, and somewhere back along the line, the first mammal had descendants which turned into both of them.
Yeah. Anyway, Russell?
Okay, so where was I? So any inconvenient facts which we come up with can just always be explained away somehow. So here's one of my other favorite examples of how creationists misuse science. It's an argument about moon dust. You've heard this one, I see.
Yeah, no, keep going.
According to Henry Morris, writing in 1974, a scientist named Hans Petersen once made an estimate of the amount of meteoric dust that falls on the moon each year. Based on these calculations, Morris claims that the dust should have been over 100 feet deep if the moon had really been around for billions of years. Then he goes on to claim that NASA scientists really considered this to be a big problem. They worried that their moon landers might sink into the dust. And of course, when they got up there, they discovered that the moon dust was less than an inch thick. And of course, supposedly that proved that the moon was less than 6,000 years old, right?
Yeah.
And I've heard creationists using this argument, in fact, still using this argument. I heard it just a couple of months ago, in fact.
Hmm.
But here's what they don't tell you. That calculation, which was made in the 1950s,
right.
was using some very faulty assumptions to make the estimate. And even then, Petersen was calling his original calculation not an exact number, but an upper limit, which means there's not more than a few hundred feet of dust on the moon.
Right.
But of course, later, as often happens in science, his mistake was recognized.
Mm-hmm.
And his calculations were redone. And the new calculation showed that, sure enough, there's supposed to be less than an inch of dust on the moon based on the amount that actually hits it.
Right.
Well,
This rebuttal hasn't gone completely unnoticed by creationists. In fact, in a 1993 paper by some guys named Snelling and Rush, the creationists themselves disavowed this argument and said, it doesn't work anymore, so stop using it, guys. But in spite of this, the same argument keeps popping up over and over again in every creationist debate. And this this just demonstrates that there is very little accountability and almost no respect for truth in creation science.
Yeah, well, it's not a science because for one thing, you know, it doesn't have many of the factors of science, which is, for example, peer review.
Right.
This whole idea that in science, what you have is like a theory is advanced, and immediately all these other people in your field check you out to see whether you're on the ball or full of it, and. You know, creationism doesn't have that parallel. In fact, no religion has that parallel.
And if you go to the Creation Research website, which is icr.org, I think, you'll see that one of the requirements of becoming a creation scientist is that you will always in the future take the Bible to be the literal truth, no matter what.
Yeah, which is anti the principles of science.
It's that no matter what part which sort of prevents any progress from being made.
Well, and it disavows it from ever being able to, you know, legitimately claim the name of being a science.
Sure.
Because in science, you have to be open to the possibility that you're wrong, and creationism isn't. Because it's not about scientific inquiry and searching into the facts and really finding out things. It's about pushing a religious dogma, a religious agenda. We're going to take a quick call from Robbie, see what he has to say this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Robbie.
Yeah.
Okay, we can't hear you in here.
Can you hear me now?
Hold on. No, hang on. We're fixing it right away. This is what we always should do before... the show goes on the air, but we were really rushed, so I can hear you in the sound room, but we need you over the speaker.
Oh, okay.
Okay, he's fixing it.
Sorry about this.
Well, this is, you know, cable access. Our little patented ACA phone problems.
Can you hear me now? Can you get me now?
Okay, well.
Okay. So just hang on for a second, Robbie, and we'll get to you in a second. Continue.
Let's see. Well, you might think that coming up with all these fake arguments, and Robbie, just jump in anytime anytime they tell you you can.
Can you hear me?
You might think that coming up with all these fake arguments and bad science would be a full-time job, and hey, you'd be right. See, there are a number of professional full-time creationists, and they're hired guns, if you will, who make it their job to go around the country.
Okay. I think we have Robbie back on. Hang on one sec. Robbie?
Yeah.
Okay, I can hear you better now. How are you doing this morning?
Oh, all right. How are you guys?
Fine.
Hey.
I'm still only hearing you in the sound room, but I can actually hear you. So if everyone's silent, we can talk.
Okay. Hey, well, they said we're not revolving. We're not getting different things. How about our appendix? They're leaving us all the time.
Yeah, see, you know, when now I can't. I'm still having problems.
Oh, okay.
Hang on. Is Vic is supposedly back in there fixing it. Okay.
Try it again.
Go ahead again, Robbie.
How about this? Can you hear me?
That's better. Okay.
Okay. They said we're not revolving as human beings. How about all of us people, all the old people that had appendix, now the new people coming on Earth don't have appendix?
new people being born don't have appendixes?
Well, yeah, most of us don't have appendix. The appendix are gone.
I haven't heard that before. Where'd you get that information?
Well, most of your, they're getting smaller and smaller. Because they're not needed, because all it did was get rid of...
See what you mean. The appendix that has in us is essentially this useless organ that used to be something at one time.
Yeah, it's disappearing.
Right.
You know, so as the generations go on, it leaves us. It's not there anymore, and you don't hear too many people that have appendicitis.
Right. On the other hand, I'm not sure that evolution would actively work against the appendix. I mean, it's not necessarily causing deaths, and that's the main operating factor in creation. I mean, in creation. In natural selection is what I mean to say.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm getting some background noise.
We're losing him.
We've lost him again. We now completely cannot hear Robbie.
Okay. I'll get you later.
Very sorry about that.
Help us, Vic.
I'll get you later.
Oh, boy. Oh, Fern Arlo. I got this.
We're bringing in the experts.
Okay, we are now. Robbie, I want to thank you for your call. I'm sorry we can't hear you. If we fix the phone problems and you want to call back and talk to us some more,
Please do, but I'm going to go ahead and let you go now. In fact, I think we just lost him. And Virginia, I know you're on the line and on hold. Please stay on the line. Well, she just hung up too. As soon as it looks like we have the phone problems fixed, we'll announce that over the air, and everybody can call back and we can start the discourse yet again. But in the meantime, let's go back over to Russell and continue with his presentation.
Okay. Well, anyway, so there are a number of professional full-time creationists, hired guns, if you will, who make it their job to go around the country and debate scientists and make it look like evolution is just a silly, outdated dogma. Oh, feedback.
Wow. Now we're all on the big speaker. Keep going.
Okay. A couple of well-known names in this area are William Lane Craig and Kent Hovind. These aren't scientists, of course. They're highly charismatic public speakers with a gift for presenting rhetoric in a way that's appealing to, well, less educated audiences. When they debate, they invariably find local opponents who are, say, small-time college professors and such. And, of course, professors are presumed to be good at explaining a complex subject, but they are also used to a little certain degree of academic honesty, which makes them not very well prepared to take on the flood of lies that creation scientists are capable of emitting.
Right, and another factor there, too, that I just interject is that a lot of professors, and I had some at UT when I was at school there, who were clearly amazingly brilliant in their field.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I had a basic astronomy professor who was, in fact, so brilliant that he found it difficult to basically teach astronomy 101, the most basic concepts, to non-science majors.
Yeah.
And so clearly he knew his stuff, but he had no public speaking, public communication skills.
Yeah, well, the skills of being a good scientist and being a good speaker in front of a room are different from each other.
Yeah, because, I mean, just being smart doesn't mean you're going to be a good performer.
Well, if you've ever watched these debates, you'd notice that they all have kind of a peculiar format. Actually, both sides get an equal amount of time to talk, so it probably looks fair. But what you'd notice is that the debate always goes something like this. The scientist gets to talk for a long time, say 45 minutes to an hour, just for the opening speech. Then the creationist gets to speak for the same amount of time. Then the scientist speaks for a short time, like 15 minutes. And then the creationist speaks for a short time. And then there's another round of even shorter rebuttals, and then a question and answer period, and then they make their closing statements. The creationist, of course, always speaks last.
Yeah.
Look again. Did you miss what happened?
Yeah.
The scientist is talking first, so he's talking for 45 minutes in a complete vacuum with no idea of what the creationist is going to say. Then the creationist gets to go on and take his time responding to all the major points of the scientist's presentation, and then he launches into an all-out attack on evolution. Mm-hmm. During this time, the creationist's objective is to fire off as many doubts and, sorry to say, lies about evolution as he possibly can. So he'll bring up Darwin's wrong quote about the eye, and then he'll bring up moon dust, and he'll pull out this phony argument about the second law of thermodynamics
right,
that creationists just love to bring up.
Right, yeah.
Anything and everything that he's gotten his bag of tricks. And the scientist is given about one-third that amount of time to try to respond to all that.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know how proficient our audience is at math, but when I think, a 45-minute speech responded in a 15-minute rebuttal, I don't think you can respond in depth to all the points that were brought up by during the first speech.
Not to mention what you've got is a college professor who's used to lecturing like this and being very straightforward with the facts and what have
right.
you, and then he's suddenly confronted by this charismatic guy who knows how to get behind a podium and entertain a crowd.
Right.
You know? And he's like, whoa. Not prepared for that either.
So naturally, what winds up happening is that most of the creationist arguments are not answered, or they're answered very briefly, and then the creationist just goes up in his final speech and says, my objections are unanswerable, and so the audience is left with this vague impression, at least some of those objections must have been valid, otherwise he would have responded.
Yeah. And anyway, just interject really quickly, I have been told the phones are okay, so if people want to call up again, there's the number, and we'll try this out one more time. But anyway, Russell, continue.
All right. So you add to this the fact that the creationists always host the debate, publicize them widely among local churches, and they make sure that the audience is mostly filled with members who are already inclined to be hostile to the evolution side. And maybe you can understand why some scientists like Stephen Jay Gould and Richard Dawkins.
Phone thing. I was just told now that they still aren't working, apparently. Hang on, folks. Well, apparently someone just did. Okay. We will be told. I've been assured. Now, if you've just called, why don't you stay on the line? Yeah, right. Yeah, so we're still FUBAR on the phones, but it looks like we do have a couple people holding. Please hold, and we'll get to you ASAP.
Okay.
Sorry to keep interrupting you, but this is a thing that,
all right.
Little Murphy's Law is hitting us today.
Right. So anyway, maybe you can understand why some scientists like Stephen Jay Gould and Richard Dawkins absolutely refuse to have public debates with creationists. And then, of course, they get called chickens.
Right.
Of course, creationists rarely participate in written debates, because then the scientists could do something unfair like, give people actual references that they can look up that prove that all these arguments are phony.
Right.
And, of course, they wouldn't be constricted by phony time constraints.
Yeah. Of course, an objection that I have always had to creation science, or just called creationism, and particularly the efforts to introduce it into public schools, is that there is just the inherent dishonesty there, which to me is the most objectionable factor. Because they want to wear the mantle of science. They want to have that respectability of being of claiming that this is we're legitimately out as a field of scientific inquiry to advance a possible alternative theory to current scientific fashions about,
I believe I can explain why this happens.
Yeah.
See, in the old days, we're talking Middle Ages, people didn't really understand or care about science that much. Basically, a priest could say whatever the heck they wanted about religion, and people would simply accept it as true because the priests were the only authority around.
Right.
As the sum of human scientific knowledge got greater and we had actual evidence that things happened one way and not another way, public awareness has sort of gradually increased. So that now science is thanks partly to public education, science is understood and accepted by most people.
Mm-hmm.
Now creationists find that it's harder to convince people that the Bible is literally true because it is counter to science, which people already recognize as true, and therefore, in order to appear respectable, creationists have to come on and present themselves as if they were scientists so that it sounds like they've got some kind of authority, which they don't automatically have as they did in the middle, in the Dark Ages.
Right. But of course, where the dishonesty lies, though, that I find particularly offensive, is that, the claim that that this is a science, just plain as, because the agenda is not to promote thinking about possible other theories. The agenda is to get specific Christian dogmas into the school under the guise of science in order to convert students to Christianity. That's the goal.
Right.
It's not to make them think about other ideas and things. It's to convert them to Christianity. So that it's not a scientific inquiry. It's a conversion effort.
Of course.
Yeah. I've been told that we are going to try to test the phones. Is that correct?
What we're going to do is have you answer the callers from in here because it's not working in the control room.
Okay, so we're all right.
Just try to pick it up and talk to them.
All right, so we are going to try that. It looks like we have someone on two, so I am going to just give this a shot. Good morning. Hello.
Sorry, folks. We don't know what to tell you.
Okay.
Okay.
Welcome to our non-call-in talk show.
Yeah, really. Nothing's coming out over the speakers, this sort of thing happens. Everyone who is on hold, please stay on hold. I'm going to put line two back on hold, and Russell will continue with his presentation.
I'm sure you at home could probably hear the callers.
Yeah, and we will just get to you when we can. We'll find,
Okay.
We'll figure this out one way or another.
Okay.
Let's keep going.
I feel kind of bad about just sitting here presenting all my side without allowing the chance for argument, because creationists do.
That's the fun of this show. We do want to, yeah, there's always next Sunday, but we do want to hope to be able to talk to folks today. So,
yeah.
Cross your fingers for us, folks, that we'll fix this problem.
Okay. Huh. So earlier I mentioned Kent Hovind as an example of one of these hired guns who goes around the country debating people.
Yeah, now who's this guy?
Well, he is, of course, a fundamentalist creationist. And one of the interesting things about him is that he's issued a formal challenge for anyone to prove that evolution is true before what he calls an impartial group of scientists. Of course, this is something that any undergraduate in biology should be able to do. Anyway,
so why hasn't anyone taken him up on it?
You can read about it on his website, which is at drdino.com. on the face of it, it looks like a legitimate offer to pay $250,000 to anyone who can provide a convincing proof that evolution through natural selection has actually occurred. It's sort of similar in spirit to the amazing Randy's challenge to prove the supernatural. Right. And of course, Hovind gets a lot out of it because now he can go around the country saying, well, nobody's ever taken my money, so
why
obviously evolution has true.
If that's what he wants.
Well, I will tell you why. It's because the challenge is bogus. Uh-huh. Big surprise, right?
No. Is it bogus because he doesn't really have the money, or that he just, whatever you
say,
he just
has the money. But anyway, first of all, the concept that it portrays as evolution is imaginary.
Okay.
One of the things that Hovind asks you to prove, and you have to prove all parts of his challenge before you can win, is that, for instance, the universe and the planets also evolved through natural selection.
What?
Okay, let me spell this out for you, Kent. Planets don't evolve.
Yeah.
See, the theory of evolution...
Planets through natural selection, so I guess the big planets eat the little planets?
I don't know. The theory of evolution, you see, only describes things that know how to reproduce.
Yeah.
And last time I looked up there, I didn't notice any planets copulating.
Yeah, but that would, you know, make astronomy a lot of fun. Wow, okay. So he has bogus stuff that he wants you to prove.
Yeah, right. And he also wants you to prove that life evolves from non-life, which, of course, also isn't true. That's abiogenesis, which is a theory that is separate from the theory of evolution. Mm-hmm. See, the theory of evolution starts out assuming that there are simple self-replicating organisms, and then it explains a way that they can become more complex and diverse to explain all the different interesting life forms that we have on Earth today. Mm-hmm. I mean, hell, Jeff sitting at home is probably going to hate this, but I mean, you know, go ahead, say that God created the first single-celled organism if you want to, and hey, I've just reconciled the theory of evolution with creation.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of Christians do actually believe that way. And of course, being an atheist, I still think they're wrong. But I mean, evolution, the point being that it's a solid scientific fact. Mm-hmm. So when creationists claim that evolution is anything but the diversification of life, either they're lying through their teeth, which they do anyway, or they're just displaying a complete ignorance of the scientific principles that they're claiming to oppose. So, of course, no one could possibly win this challenge because it's asking them to prove something that isn't true, which I think is a logical impossibility, isn't it?
Yeah, all its presuppositions are faulty. It's, you know, setting up the straw man.
Right.
Do we want to try to guys?
No, there's no one there.
No one there.
No
okay.
One.
Oh, I see. That's just them testing stuff. Okay. We'll let you know when the phones are back on.
A reminder, some of the links to some of the research that I did are on the web at rglasser.home.texas.net/atheism.
And we'll get that URL up.
Eventually.
I think they're concentrating on the phone line.
No,
I'll
take the URL right now.
Yeah, they're all...
okay.
We have our crack team of phone guys in there trying to figure out the phone situation. Yeah.
Right. Once again, rglasser.home.texas.net/atheism. Okay, now there's another reason why Hovind's challenge is flawed, apart from the fact that it's not clear whether he has the money or not. We also don't have any idea who these supposedly impartial witnesses are who are going to judge this thing, because Hovind hasn't ever offered any names. In fact, whenever people ask him, well, who's on your panel, he, of course, dodges the question and says, well, they're all well-respected scientists.
Okay, right. I'm going to test the phones right now. Which line, Vic? Any of them? They're all blinking.
It doesn't work for
mine. Okay. Well, so scratch that.
Righto. Anyway, so he doesn't give us any names. What are we supposed to assume, Kent, except that all of your panel are a bunch of professing fundamentalists who, of course, are going to reject everything that comes across their desk.
Yeah, yeah. That was what was fascinating to me about the calls last week that we were actually able to hear.
Mm-hmm.
The claims that were made by, we had two callers in particular, I think, a couple of creationists. And it was, one guy, I believe, said something like, well, you know, give me an example of a transitional form for like a certain animal.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, look, a transitional form for that animal would be that animal.
Yeah.
Hello.
Oh, caller.
We have a, hello.
Or is that someone in the control room?
Yeah, you're hearing this live, folks. It's an interesting experiment that's going on television, and you're seeing it. Anyway, just to continue.
It's because Jeff's gone. He jinxed it.
That's it. He wanted this example, and I tried to give him the best and clearest example that I could give. And when I was done, he was like, well, you just can't even give me an example. You know, it's almost like this sort of flat denial that they want to, whatever you tell them.
Well, he was probably asking for something in the past that eventually became a modern butterfly. Of course, I think a transitional form for a butterfly would be hard to produce fossil evidence for, because as I understand it, fossils are only formed by things that have hard parts.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't have too many. I think the only prehistoric insects we have are the ones preserved in amber. And
this is another issue that creationists bring up, because I've heard the creationist argument that, well, if evolution was really true, then there ought to be billions and billions of fossils that prove evolution. Well, we don't even have billions and billions of fossils, period.
Yeah. I mean, we're digging them up as fast as we can, folks, but, you know, you got to find them first.
right.
But, you know, the funny thing is, you just go out to, you know, the deserts of West Texas with a, you know, fork and probably find, you know, a few things out there.
I don't know if it's that easy.
Well,
I've never tried.
That. Okay, that's probably an exaggeration. But, you know, it's not hard to just uncover stuff, you know, just find this stuff. What else do we have?
Well, I'm actually... Well, there's an interesting essay on my links page which chronicles one person's attempt to lay out some ground rules and claim the reward. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's been stonewalled at every turn. He tried to propose alternative, he tried to simply establish what Kent Hovind would accept as proof.
Mm-hmm.
And this was even before he submitted any evidence, so this is kind of entertaining, because he keeps saying, okay, let's put down some names for your judges, and Kent Hovind says, just give me the proof! and he says, okay, I would like the money to be put in an escrow account for a third party who will swear to deliver it if everything works out. And he says, give me the proof!
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that's quite an interesting read. And on another site, there's also a little essay, which is simply a detailed, actually it's a very long essay, which is simply a detailed reading of one of Kent Hovind's sermons.
Huh.
And in this essay, what he does is he goes through and picks out all the obvious factual errors.
Uh-huh.
Not simply opposing his religion or anything like that, just picking out things that are objectively, factually wrong.
Mm-hmm.
The number of errors he found is kind of summed up in the title of the essay, which is 300 Lies by Kent Hovind. So it's...
We have to route around this control room to the other control room. That means we have to run a runner back and forth on you which line.
Right.
We have a fear there,
okay. I've just been told that we are doing this sort of interesting rerouting trick with the phone lines to try to get them to work. So this involves guys running back and forth from one control room to another.
Supposed to be Matt on line two. Keeson.
Yeah.
Say,
Right. But I've been told now that I'm going to experiment with line two. Supposedly there's a mat on. Yeah, hopefully the thing won't blow up in my hands. If we get to talk to Matt, we get to talk to Matt, and that'll be terrific. So let's try this. Ew, feedback. Heavy feedback.
That's us.
That's us.
That's not Matt.
Hello, Matt?
That's us and our microphones.
Hello.
We have no Matt.
We have no Matt. Guys, what is happening this morning? Sorry.
I would just proceed with the show without...
Right. So we're just going to go on with it then.
I guess we're going to... I'm almost done here. Okay. So we're going to have to come up with something to discuss.
Oh, we will. Don't worry. There's always plenty to discuss, a never ending. And and we also had one of our crew wanted to interject a point at some point. So we'll just let that happen. But I'm really sorry about this, folks. I mean, it's...
we're not trying to stop you from arguing.
Is this a new number on the...
What I think we need to do is just go ahead and do the show without any dollars. Because it doesn't seem like...
It doesn't look like... Okay. Darn it. Well, that's a real shame. I have just been told that it just doesn't look like we're going to fix the phone situation, which is a major disappointment. Part of the fun of this show is to be able to take calls from both atheists and Christians and debate topics with you. I was really looking forward to that.
I was, too.
You know, I'm sorry that... No, I'm serious. What's that snicker snort about, Howard? Yeah, get off of it. No, really. And so the fact that we're not going to be able to do that is very disappointing.
But it's still going to be a great show, so keep watching.
So keep watching and, you know, take notes and call us back next week and yell at us if you want to. Hopefully maybe, you know, and Paul, if you want to interject something, you can probably, can Paul get on the mic in the sound room and come over the speaker?
Do you mind if I take this
talk to us? Yeah. We're going to go ahead and just get rid of this, say bye-bye to the phone thing.
Bye, phone.
Bye, you piece of crap.
Maybe you should probably put up our voicemail number and website.
We're going to get the voicemail number up and the website URL up. And again, thanks everyone for watching. This is Atheist Experience, ordinarily a call-in show, but not this morning, it would seem, darn it.
But you can come down to the bagel shop and talk with us.
Atheists, agnostics, and atheist-friendly people only. The bagel shop is a social gathering for unbelievers. It is not a forum for Christians to come and try to convert us. We will eject you if that's the case. You know, where it's a social gathering strictly.
Look out for a guy named Howard if you...
look out. Yeah, we'll sick Howard on it. Howard hasn't had his biscuit this morning, so he's ravenous. He's frothing at the mouth. But anyway, keep watching, atheists and Christians alike, because we do have a lot to talk about. And again, my pet peeve with creationism, the attempt to interject it into the schools, you know, and this claim that it is some sort of legitimate alternative. And a lot of Christians say, well, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with having both theories, okay, both evolution and creationism in the schools? Well, first off, the main problem is creationism isn't science. Once again, it's rooted in, for example, it's rooted in the dogma that God exists and he created the universe, which are two... Mm-hmm. Points that have not.
And you realize, of course, Christianity is taught in schools. It's called humanities class. It's taught alongside, the ancient Greek religions and.
So, in terms of a comparative religions, you mean? In the schools that offer that,
it's discussed.
Yeah, you know, some of the precepts.
This usually doesn't come up until college.
Right.
But, of course, that's the appropriate place for it, not a science class.
Yeah. But another problem with that, of course, is you run into the problem of, okay, well, if it's really a matter of equal time, then shouldn't it be equal time for all of it?
Right.
I mean, shouldn't we, for example, talk about the ancient Norse creation myth in which the first man and first woman were licked out of a block of ice by a gigantic cow?
Something like that. I don't think you got that exactly right.
Well, it's a paraphrasing probably, but I mean, it's no less ridiculous than, a guy being rolled out of a ball of dough and then he plucked his rib out and, it's no less silly than that.
You mean Adam?
Yeah. And then where will it stop? You know, if creationism is offered in biology class as an alternative to current scientific theory, then what are we going to have?
History is going to be retaught.
Yeah, are we going to have the white supremacists say, well, we think that Holocaust revisionism should be taught in history class as an alternative.
Equal time.
Yeah, equal time. Are we going to have flat earthers, saying that they should have their theories taught in geography class as an alternative to theories that the world is round? I mean, believe it or not, there are people living today.
There are flat earthers.
Yeah, living today who have a Bible-based belief.
They have a website, but I didn't put that one.
Yeah, well, too bad. But so that's the problem with it. You know, it'll get to the point where the schools are now, you know, any wacko with any cockamamie theory can just call, you know, can just demand, get in front of, you know, his congressman or something and demand that his wacko ideas be presented as a legitimate alternative. And then truth becomes this wackily subjective concept, which a lot of, you know, Christians believe it is. Remember, we had that minister who came and spoke to our lecture series.
I was not at that.
You weren't there. Boy, yeah, you could have really ripped on him. Well, a lot of us did. Paul Wilson did, and we'll probably talk to Paul here in a minute. But one of this guy's basic precepts when he got up and gave his talk was that truth is subjective. You know, so, you know, that would seem to be kind of the school system that the creationists want.
Maybe he was just trying to pander to atheists, thinking that we believe truth is subjective.
He must have. I think he really genuinely thought that that was what we thought.
Yeah.
You know, but what are you going to have, though? Are you going to have schools? Are you going to have a school system in which it sort of works like this? Good morning, children. Welcome to your first day of class. Okay, here's your first lesson. 2 + 2 either equals 3, 4, or 5. Why don't you choose the answer that you feel best about, and that'll be the right answer for you. Now go out and deal with the world. It doesn't work, you know. Just believing in things that are completely stupid and faulty and have no basis in fact is going to leave you really, really handicapped for dealing with life. You know?
True.
Okay.
Anyway, just to finish up.
Oh, yeah.
Usually, a lot of times when parents and teachers, they're faced with the underhanded tactics of creation scientists, what happens is people just throw up their hands and ignore the issue entirely. And we saw that dramatically illustrated by, of course, the Kansas Board of Education last year, who decided that they weren't going to require that evolution gets taught anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I think that this is a serious mistake, and I'll tell you why. What parents and teachers sometimes don't understand is that evolution is not only a well-established fact, but it's also the central fact of biology. Without it, nothing else really makes sense. And I know this firsthand, because in high school, I took a biology class from a teacher who decided that he should go ahead and skip evolution. I hated every minute of high school biology because it was just a completely random collection of facts and words to be memorized for me. And
so you had no real understanding of what biology was all about.
Right. To this day, I have the words endoplasmic reticulum burned into my brain, and I don't remember what it means.
Yeah, it's just there. You know, it becomes this sort of rote memorization, which isn't education. It's not learning.
But it wasn't until I got to college I had to take a biology class, so I picked out one about evolution because I thought that was controversial.
Mm-hmm.
When I actually learned what the whole thing was all about, it astounded me because for the first time, I actually realized that biology was a science.
Mm-hmm.
A science where you investigate and make theories and decide that certain things are true and certain things are not true, and not just giving names to all the parts you find when you dissect a frog. And of course, later in life, actually recently, I've started reading a lot of books by Dawkins, and I've been reading the talkorigins.org website. And the subject has become really fascinating to me, and I've rediscovered an interest in biology, which high school almost killed for me.
It's like high school kills reading as a hobby, you know. I mean, when you equate reading books with, English class assignments, it sort of kills the whole idea that picking up a book to read it for pleasure is a
fun thing to do. Yeah, it took a while to get over that, too.
Yeah, that's a drama.
Anyway, so, I mean, evolution is what really made the history of life come alive for me.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm urging people not to let creationists get away with what they're trying to accomplish.
Yeah. Some of the other fallacious arguments that you hear from creationists are, of course, the various design arguments for God. And, of course, you know, these have all been punctured, and I'll get to some of that in a minute. But then what seemed interesting to me, and we heard a little evidence of this from a caller last week,
mm-hmm.
was this whole sort of selective thinking about this kind of thing, where they want to have, well, it's known in philosophy as the God of the gaps.
Right.
Know. They want to have this God that doesn't have to obey any rules, you know, and in so doing, he's very convenient to sort of plug in to whatever kind of hole you want to plug him into.
Right. Anytime we have something that scientist hasn't quite completely worked out yet.
Yeah. So what had last week was a guy who, you know, just, you know, he couldn't get past the idea. This all had to have been planned. You know, this wonderful complex world, it couldn't have just come about. It all had to have, there has to be a plan behind it. And so I immediately hit him with, you know, the question that he deserved to be hit with, which was, okay, well, who planned it and who planned him? Okay? You know, and, you know, who, if your God designed this world, who designed your God? And he immediately, of course, well, nobody. My God always
has... He was always around.
He's always around. And here's the fallacy with that line of thinking, and this is why, you know, a lot of these creationist arguments are pure nonsense. Because what you have is a situation in which, and I've been told we have phones back.
Huzzah!
Yeah. Of course, don't believe that until we actually push the button
right,
and we hear a voice.
Because we need to provide objective evidence.
Right, we need to provide, yes, we need to. Anyway, here, the central fallacy is, of course, you know, what you got is, okay, by his own arguments, okay, by his own rules that he set up, okay, he believes that the complexity of the universe requires design. Okay, mm-hmm. His belief in design is rooted in the complexity that he sees in the world around him. Right. It had to have been designed. So if complexity requires a designer, doesn't it stand to reason that some entity capable of creating this complex universe must be at the very least equally complex, if not more complex?
Okay? That is certainly true.
And if by your own rules, by that guy's rules, okay, then if the universe had to have been designed because of its complexity, an equally complex designer would have had to have been designed.
Creationists will just call that a silly question.
Yeah,
and
but
not
he just wants
it.
To ignore that. It's similar to there's an analogy made. I think it might have even been in this book, Atheism.
We have some callers now.
We do.
Sydney
really
from last week is back.
Well, just the whole situation of, you know, like the Hindus. I think it was them who said, you know, thought that well, what's holding up the world? Oh, the world is sitting on the back of a giant elephant. And then one of them thought, oh, wait a minute, well, what could the elephant be sitting on? He's sitting on the back of a giant turtle. And they're like, oh, well, wait a minute, well, then what's the turtle sitting on? And then they just decide, well, we'll stop there.
Well, the answer to that is, it's turtles all the way down.
Yeah, it's turtles all, so it's this kind of infinite regress, and they just want to ignore this. So there are just so many logical fallacies that are involved in their arguments, and we might get a chance to hear some more if the phones are working. So let's cross our fingers and go to line one with, whoops, that didn't work. Steve?
Hi.
Barely coming
sort
through.
Of.
Keep talking and let's see if we can.
Well, I just wanted to say that through your fumbling this morning, you have actually reached God.
We didn't hear that.
I'm kidding.
Okay, yeah. Okay, no.
We opened a rift in the space-time continuum.
Exactly.
Oh, we can hear you great now. Okay.
Okay, my question was this. You bring out all these points about like the Kansas City issue. What is actually being done to counter this movement of creationist science? Could you speak about, you know, what organization, if there is any, that's actively and focused towards countering this?
There is an organization called the Center for Scientific Education, I think.
Something like that.
A lot of scientists simply wave off creationists and say that they're silly and they shouldn't even be dignified with a response.
But we can't really afford that position.
Right.
And I don't really know of a follow-up to anything that's happened in Kansas specifically, but I do know that recently, for example, in New Mexico, and it may have been inspired as sort of a response to the whole Kansas debacle, New Mexico overwhelmingly approved evolution as a thing to teach and talk about, and this was led by a large contingent of scientists from throughout the state, and they got the Kansas the New Mexico legislature to overwhelmingly give a thumbs up to science and evolution teaching in the schools and a big thumbs down to creationism, equal time, what have you. So I would suggest that these kinds of efforts just have to really be done on a grassroots level. Guys like us, you and me, and people who, you know, support getting proper science in science class and leave the religion, you know, at the home with the individual families, whatever they want to do about it. Because it really is, you know, that's an individual issue. It's not the state's or the school's business to start, you know, shoving any religious dogmas down anyone's throats in the guise of, you know, school, classroom environments or otherwise. So I think it just has to be, you know, grassroots efforts, you know, put together by citizens and hopefully organizations like ours can do something about that.
If I could interrupt, this is obviously not Steve anymore.
Oh, hi.
but, I was watching, and I agree with a lot of what you say, but you also have to look at what the other side is doing. I mean, you see these little fundamentalist churches, setting up shop in strip shopping malls all the time.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Everywhere. And, you know, although I agree with a lot of what you say, I don't see the passion that the other side has. And if that passion doesn't come forth, you know, where people of like minds have places to congregate other than bagel shops and Sunday.
Right. Yeah, I got to agree with you there. I mean,
just a second. Your evolutionary destiny is to fall to the wayside, and we all become fundamentalists. I mean, honestly speaking, that's what I see.
Ooh, what a scary thought! No,
I know.
Actually, ma'am, I do agree with you. We are, for one thing, we are overwhelmingly outnumbered in the general population. That's for true. And you know, it is difficult for, you know, those of us who want to get up and talk about facts and figures and rationalism and rational approaches to things to compete with, for example, like the showmanship of fundamentalist churches and the way in which they have sort of, you know, made a show business out of their religion. You know, you're right, it is difficult to appeal to, because what you have to understand is in those environments and in those churches, they're pandering to kind of base emotional, you know, responses that people have to things. Whereas when you're sitting down with someone and you're trying to have a conversation and you're advancing ideas and debate, you know, yeah, it's not exactly show business, I will admit. And you're right. I mean, you know, compared to, you know, I think it's a shame that, you know, ACA only has really a handful of members compared to, you know, the average street corner, even shopping strip mall church, which has hundreds of people flooding to it every Sunday. It's you know, that's been a process that's been going on for a couple millennia. Religion is ingrained in our culture, in our society. We are, for the most part, brought up from infancy to believe in the teachings of various religions, mostly in our country, Christianity. And because of the fact that it is so woven into our culture, it is a hard thing to combat. I mean, we're talking about, you know, going against something that has kind of, you know, held the top billing for a couple of millennia now. And so you're right, it's a long, long uphill climb that we've got. But I think for our little part at the ACA, you know, in the few years ACA has been in existence, we've come a long way. And for our few numbers, we now have, we're about to have a second television show. We're going out with our outreach programs more aggressively. Doing more things in the community to let ourselves get seen. And these things happen slowly, but they happen through the dedication of dedicated folks. So I agree with you, but I hope that, you know, you're wrong about we all end up on the slippery slope downhill to fundamentalism. We just got to stick to our guns. I'm sorry, I rambled on. I hope that answered your point.
What line's on?
But anyway, I don't think we have a line on, so I'm just going to release one because that's what I was on, and I'm going to go to Cindy on two. So thank you for calling. And go to Cindy on two.
Hello?
Good morning, Cindy.
Hello, Cindy.
Yeah, hello.
Hi there.
There's a couple of points I wanted to make.
Sure.
About the ongoing, like, current evolution thing. I mean, wouldn't viruses and bacteria that evolved to become resistant to drugs, isn't that a form of evolution?
Yes, sure. They do evolve.
Okay, and then a couple Absolutely. Of years ago, and maybe y'all could check this out, because I'm not on the internet or anything like that. I don't have a lot of access. But I remember reading an article about the Chernobyl disaster in Russia, mm-hmm. you know, several years back.
Right.
And a couple of years ago, some biologists, I read this article that they went over there to do a study that life was coming back to a lot of the areas but that had killed off all the animals and insects. And
right.
animals and plant life and insects were coming back into the area, and they were studying them, and they found that they were actually, the animals and plant life that were coming back were becoming resistant to high doses of radiation.
Huh.
That's very interesting.
Something you could check out, because I don't really have a way. I don't know where I read the article.
Huh.
But wouldn't that be a form of current evolution?
Well, it would be a form of, I guess, adaptation to environmental change, which would probably fall under the rubric of evolution, I suppose. Not being a professional scientist, we can like tell you for sure, but it's definitely something that I find intriguing, and I guess it'd be worth getting on the internet and doing a word search on Chernobyl and seeing what you find out.
Yeah, and also something else I wanted to kind of do a plug for a favorite author of mine.
You go right ahead.
Are you familiar with the Bishop John Shelby Spong? He's pretty radical and outspoken. Sometimes he's on Politically Incorrect.
Yes. He had a book called Why Christianity Must Change or Die.
Yes. Okay, that's a current book. But he has a book that he had written several years ago. It was called Rescuing the Bible from Fundamentalism. And
right.
In there, he kind of looks, rationally. He's a very rational, outspoken. Of course, he's almost like blasphemous, I guess. He's a spiritual priest.
Yeah, well, he's a Catholic, so isn't he?
And,
so that's like a thumbs down.
One thing he talked about that I found interesting was about the flood. And right. According to the Bible, the flood, the water would have had to have covered the entire earth, including the highest mountain, which we know would have to be Everest.
Right.
So he actually wrote down and calculated how many, billions upon billions upon billions of gallons of water, the amount of water that would have covered the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, there's no way, there's nowhere that water could have ever gone. It was so much water that it couldn't have even gone into the earth.
Well, God had this big straw.
Yeah. Yeah. Creationists will figure out something to come up with to rebut that.
So I would like to recommend that any fundamentalist watching your show, because I myself am a Christian, but not fundamentalist, that
Christians.
Go ahead and check out that book, if nothing else, just to get them mad.
Yeah. Well, that's always fun.
Okay.
And we have stuff happening with the light.
The
that's
light's
fun.
Flickering.
All we had to say.
All right. Well, thank you so much
for
your call.
Thanks for your comments.
And we'll check out that Chernobyl information.
Yeah.
And it looks like we might have some radioactive stuff happening.
It's very interesting because I thought, maybe there's hope for us, too. You know?
You just might be true. Well, thank you for calling, and we hope to talk to you again sometime.
Okay.
What was I going to? I had a thought, and it just kind of fluttered away. Maybe it'll come back to me as we talk to Virginia on 3. Virginia?
Hi there.
Hi, thanks
Hi,
for
Jenny.
Calling us back. We've had a funky morning.
Yeah, you guys, though, have really come back with a beautiful recovery. I applaud your
We've evolved.
There and keep on keeping on. But no, I had several comments to make.
Sure.
The first comment that I tried to call in much earlier was when we were on the subject of transitional forms, and you read an article that I actually watched a documentary on cable last, it was a couple nights back about dinosaurs. And there are many interesting finds that are happening in Mongolia in particular.
Oh, yeah. Did you see the very beginning of the show?
Yeah, I did. And that's why I bring this up. Because the raptors that they have found fossils for in the Gobi Desert they're calling them Gobi raptors, and they're different from velociraptors in that they are smaller. Their heads are smaller, but they're definitely related. They're like cousins or something.
Yeah, this article that I read, I think, said that these were at least the one they dug up was about the size of a coyote.
Yes.
Which is certainly smaller than the ones in Jurassic Park,
at least. Right. Velociraptors are Western fossils that have been found, and they are larger. They're about 6 foot tall. Anyhow... Okay. Going on to people demanding that we produce transitional forms and something that is more easy for them to understand that is a transitional form, there has been a breakthrough in science. A form has been found. It is a raptor-looking type dinosaur with feathers. And they have actually confirmed that those are feathers that have been fossilized. And
is that, are you talking about an Archaeopteryx?
I'm sorry, what?
Are you talking about an Archaeopteryx?
I don't remember the name.
Yeah, that's one of the early, bird type.
Well, no, this came after.
Okay.
There was an early bird type fossil found. They were not conclusive.
I think I've heard something about this, too.
Feathers. They talked about it possibly being muscle fibers that had fossilized. But then they found this other dinosaur fossil where the actual structure of the feathers are in no doubt. And they definitely know that those were feathers. So that's pretty transitional. And then
Sounds like it. Then
I just had another comment that spawned after listening to a couple of your callers. One of the ladies said that, that, you know, atheists are, we're not showy, and, you know, I understand, you know, the mm-hmm. comment and the conversation that took place there. However, I would like to make a comment that though we do appear to be outnumbered, yet we are outnumbered in the United States, but certainly not worldwide when you look at the bigger picture. Plus, there are very many atheists that are in the closet that, you know, are not ready to come out into society with their views.
Yeah, there are a lot of them are just afraid of the A word.
Yes, so it's like you had, and many people are agnostic, and many people don't care one way or the other.
Right.
So, you know, you have this big movement of people that are just not out there and vocal about, you know, their belief system. So we're never going to head down the Sunday path, and I think that fundamentalists portray such a small portion of Christianity that they're no danger or no threat whatsoever. And
but they do have this tendency of just being, as you said, showy and vocal.
Yes.
And, you know, just sure, for every
more power to them, because you know what, they obviously are ridiculous.
Yeah.
And so take that seriously unless you're uneducated and you don't use your brain to think for yourself. And unfortunately, people like that are going to be the people that eventually don't survive on this planet, because it is about survival of the fittest, mm-hmm. survival of the strongest, and obviously people who are using their brains effectively are the ones that are going to rule.
I hope you are right. Oh boy, do I ever hope you are right. Of course, there's another aspect in our culture of being quote-unquote fittest, and that's having lots of money to get your word out.
Right.
And fundamentalists just have this wonderful ability to end up loaded, whatever it takes. You know, like I said, this campus crusade for Christ that pissed off half of Florida by sending out their Jesus videos to all the Jewish residents of Palm Beach, just on that mail-out, they spent $1.2 million. Okay, I mean, that's just like, you know, I mean, for an atheist organization to raise that kind of money would be well-nigh miraculous. But, you know, it's a matter of not only simply being outnumbered, but even though they are a small part of Christianity, like you said, most mainstream Christians aren't just that gonzo where they take the Bible absolutely literally.
If you will, an evolution in religion, because people are turning away from fundamentalist ideas because they just can't hold water anymore. So in an effort to voice their religion as being more credible, you know, you have Christians that are saying, oh, fundies are ridiculous.
Well, yeah, there are a lot of Christians out there who are, you know, coming, you know, not afraid to come out and say fundies are idiots. There aren't that many of them. I think most Christians, you know, want to say, you know, hey, live and let live, and they have a right to their views too. So they're a lot of Christians, whereas they might think that fundies are stupid, aren't exactly going to come right out and tell them to shut up, because when it gets right down to it, they are fellow Christians. Another reason why I'm not quite as optimistic as you are about fundamentalism dying out because its ideas are stupid, you have to understand fundamentalism really isn't about ideas. You know, these sorts of beliefs are emotionally motivated. These are people who get into this sort of thing because it fills this sort of emotional need. For example, the whole motivation, I think, behind the belief in, like, Jesus Christ as a personal savior, and, for example, referring to God as your heavenly father, all of these concepts are motivated by, like, this need that you have to feel that there is this divine parent watching over you.
Yes.
And there are all sorts of emotional and psychological motivations. Yeah, I mean, if religion were entirely, I mean, if emotion, human emotion weren't a factor, for example, fear of death, the desire that when you die, you'll get to see your loved ones that passed before you again and hug them again. You know, this religion is about, you know, humans sort of giving into their human emotional impulses.
Instead of dealing with life on a factual basis.
Yeah, I mean, it's not just cold hard fact. And to an extent, I can understand that. For example, you know, I have nothing but sympathy for somebody who, like, has lost a loved one and, you know, and drops to their knees and prays because they're sad.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but that's just humans being human. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when it gets to the realm of fundamentalism where they try to advance these things as legitimate scientific theories, that's a whole other ball of wax. But anyway, look, we have enjoyed the heck out of talking to you, but we've got 15...
Sure, I understand. Y'all keep on. It's great.
Call us next week and come to the bagel shop if you're so inclined. And we hope to talk to you again soon. We got 3 more callers to get to, so we're going to do it now.
See you at the bagel shop.
See ya. Okay, let's go to Tom on 1. Good morning, Tom.
Good morning, guys.
How are
Good morning,
you doing?
Tom.
I'm doing well. This is the only show during the week that I actually tune into. I surf and otherwise sort of grays, but this is the one I actually wake up for and turn on.
Well, thank you so much. Even on our
what a sentiment.
Yeah, even on our technically faulty days, you'll stick with us. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I will. It's been tougher today, but
we overcame. Well, what'd you like to talk about today?
Well, I'd just like to offer an additional argument to the alternative science theory. If you can teach creationism alongside evolution. Why can't you teach meteorology that way too? You know, some very important religions for a long time believed that Zeus was tossing thunderbolts,
mm-hmm.
and that's as legitimate a
Or teach astrology as part of an astrology class. Is
but
well, sure, and you know, astrology for a long time had been very deeply interwoven to the Christian teaching.
Yeah, but it's interesting that you should mention meteorology. I'm glad you did, because that's often another thing that I like to sort of toss at design argument spouting creationists. If the world had a grand designer, mm-hmm. why do we have weather? Okay, I mean, like, if this planet was put here to, like, house us as life forms and be optimal for our survival, why isn't it sunny, blue, clear, 68 degrees all over the world every day of the year?
Well, you know,
why do we have tornadoes and hurricanes that kill tens of thousands of people?
Because those people are wicked.
Yeah, right. Try to tell me that, you know, a four-year-old child in the third world is wicked and deserves to be killed by a hurricane.
A four-year-old child in the third world is wicked and deserves to be killed.
That's right. Because
I can say it with a straight face, so can they.
No, you're smiling, Russell. Oh.
If you're a Hindu, you could believe that the four-year-old child led an evil earlier life and deserves everything he gets.
Ah, there you are.
But,
yeah.
But if you're a Westerner, you can say, well, you were born with original sin, so you deserve everything you get.
Yeah, that's one of the more disturbing facets of Christian belief. The guys who actually, the ones who actually believe that if a child dies before receiving Jesus, it'll go to hell.
I mean,
holy mackerel, what kind of psychotic thing is that? But anyway, anything else?
There's plenty of stuff, but I'll save it for next week.
Yeah, okay. Try calling us next week when presumably we'll do the phone thing a little more smartly than we did today. And thanks for your call,
thanks
and come visit us if you feel up to it at the bagel shop today.
Thanks, man.
Take care, sir.
Okay, bye.
Okay, guess who we have on line two? Our fearless, stopped-up leader, Jeff D. Let's see what Jeff has to say, shall we?
Morning, Jeff.
Morning, Jeff.
Hi, guys.
How are you?
Oh, I'm okay. I nearly came down there this morning.
Hey, look what happens when you miss a show for 1 week. The whole thing goes to hell.
I wouldn't want to be part of that embarrassing fiasco.
Oh, well.
Oh, was it that bad?
No, you guys have actually done quite a good job.
Why, thank you.
I just wanted to, I've been trying to call in since the discussion about, atheists apparently lacking the emotional fervor of fundamentalists, and that's why
you certainly don't.
Previous caller suggested.
Yeah.
There's a serious, serious problem in our culture, which is that belief, just by itself, divorced from any concerns about accuracy or, facts,
right.
Belief itself is considered a good thing.
Right.
And that's just horrifyingly bad for our culture.
Yeah, I would agree with you. What we have is a culture that has promoted this idea that the uncritical acceptance of whatever sort of wacky idea comes your way is considered being open-minded, and that's a virtue.
Right.
Whereas skepticism is equated with cynicism, and you're just being a stuffy old stuff shirt, and you're no fun, and you're just,
like they say, you want to be open-minded, but not so much that your brains fall out.
And what we have is a whole culture full of people who have confused open-mindedness with gullibility.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, right. I think what we see with atheists is, atheism is not something that's beat into your emotional makeup, but by virtue of this idea that just believe it and that'll make you good, that'll be a wonderful thing if you just believe.
Mm-hmm.
What you see with atheism is a bunch of people who don't think we were planted here like geraniums by some cosmic being, mm-hmm. to serve his purposes. Mm-hmm. We have our own purposes. We have lives, we have careers, we have better things to do with our time.
Mm-hmm.
But we rouse ourselves and we drag ourselves down to that TV studio and we put on that TV show because we still recognize that this is an important message to get out there to the public, You know, it's not about the glories of just belief in some cosmic wonderful thing.
Right.
It's about facts.
Yeah.
You know, that's the thing.
It's using your mind.
So there is no, you know, there is no clergy of atheism.
Right.
There are no guys whose job it is to whip us all into an emotional frenzy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, thank God there aren't.
Well, we were actually going to do an altar call at the end of the show.
Thank who?
Yeah. And do a big sing-along where everyone claps. But anyway, no, you're dead on, man, as always. And how are you feeling?
Oh, well, you know, I'll be better by Tuesday, I hope, for our weekly Buffy viewing.
Yeah, well, I hope you're actually better by tomorrow night, because, you know, all our characters in Gaming Night are about to
get killed. Oh, gosh, that too, yeah.
So anyway.
I didn't hear you announce the Godless Gamers.
Oh, that's right, Godless Gamers, Monday night, 7:30 p.m. at the home of Vic Farrow. There we go.
I may well be well enough to run then.
Well, we hope
if
to see
not,
you.
I recommend that all you guys bring some board games.
All right. Well, we'll have some backup. But anyway, good to hear from you, Jeff. We got 11 minutes and three more guys online. We're going to try to get
Go for it. I'll go back to listening to you on the internet.
All right, man. We'll see you.
See ya.
Bye.
Okay. Oops, I didn't release that properly. Now I did. Okay, we're going to go to now Stephen on line 4. Good morning, Stephen.
Hi, how are you?
Hello, we're just
Stephen.
Fine, sir. How are you doing this morning?
Oh, fine. I've got a couple questions for you.
Yes, sir.
I actually believe, or did believe, in evolution at one time, and a friend of mine has now proposed some things to me that are really bringing up some big question marks when it comes to evolution.
Such as?
Well, they actually, you know, showed me some documents and some information that makes it highly questionable as to the age of the Earth. And, you know, I'd always thought the Earth was billions of years old.
It's 5 billion to be precise.
Okay.
Give or take a few million.
Well, the Earth
they
is...
Questioned, they asked me, how do I know that it's 5 billion years old? And I didn't really have a whole lot to say. What kind of evidence do you know that I could tell these people that the Earth is 5 billion years old or something of that nature?
Well, there is an entire science called stratigraphy. Would that be accurate? I think that's the name. All sorts of evidence from the archaeological record, geological records.
The geologic column, is that what you're talking about?
There's evidence from, there are all sorts, there's not one specific scientific discipline that I think that addresses
that. Right, basically just a wide variety of sciences have established in all kinds of different ways. I mean, you know, you've got radiometric dating from one science, and you've got... you know, observing Doppler shift or whatever of the stars from astronomy. I mean, I'm a computer scientist, so I'm not really versed on all these specific sciences.
Yeah, I tried to entertain some of those to the limited knowledge that I had, and I was defeated very badly. For instance, the geologic column, their theory is that the there was a flood about 4,400 years ago.
That's
that one.
Okay.
You've heard that. And then that the Earth was created about 6,000 or so years ago.
So these people are young Earth creationists.
It seems that way.
Okay.
Do you use the internet?
I do.
Have you been to talkorigins.org? Because I think they have the best materials that you're looking for. They have a very wide, they have a large listing of different creationist arguments and tactics and answers to every single one of them, and I think that would be a great place to start.
What's the name again?
TalkOrigins.org.
I'll check it. Yeah, their argument, of course, on the geologic column was that 4,400 years ago there was a flood.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And supposedly that would mean that there's nothing under the flood layer or something?
No, that there would be many, many layers that would actually contribute to the geologic column.
Right, but that doesn't explain why the things that we consider to be old are always on the bottom.
Well, I tried that too.
Right.
And,
well, see,
and the fact is that, you know, shells are on the bottom of the ocean, and then that would, of course, be the first layer.
Yeah, but things are sorted by weight when they're all put together naturally.
But
there's
no
evidence of that in the geological.
Yeah. I'll address the issue just in a very basic form. Imagine that there's a nuclear war. Okay, if you're talking, let's talk about, like, specifically the flood as related to the Noah story in the Bible.
Okay.
Okay, which incidentally was borrowed from the Babylonians, the legend of Zeosudra, it's in the Epic of Gilgamesh, but that's so much for that. Anyway, imagine a world teeming with civilization. A deity looks down and decides, I don't like these people anymore, I'm going to wipe them all out with a flood.
Who'd imagine such a crazy thing?
Okay, imagine a similar situation. Okay, let's say a nuclear war takes place that kills everybody in the world except maybe 4 or 5 people. okay, what you would have would be, in the archaeological record, there would be like this complete stop, okay, at one point. You would have evidence for civilizations, and then everything would suddenly quit. And then it would start to reemerge from the very beginning again until we are to where we are now.
Yeah, but okay?
There is no such evidence in the geological record or the archaeological record of such an event, of such a global cataclysm.
Well, that just proves exactly what they said, because the geologic column would show that there's different levels of, sediment that has fossils within those different levels of sediment, and that would actually show evidence that what they're saying is true, because the flood, if you imagine a massive flood, what they're saying is that all of this stuff would settle out in different layers. Just like you have one of those things where you shake it up and then it forms all these different layers in water.
Okay, but anyway, we only have about 6 minutes to go, and we're going to try to take another couple callers, but let me just answer you quickly by saying a couple things. First off, do go to talkorigins.org. And look over some of the information there, because I think you'll find it very enlightening. And once again, think about, how much water would it have taken to cover the entire surface of the Earth, including Mount Everest, and then where would it all go? Creationists and young Earth creationists always have an answer that they've made up for everything. The point is, there was never a worldwide flood. It didn't happen. Period.
Okay. Well, They did say that there's documented evidence, not just in one culture, but in numerous cultures.
And the reason for that is because where do most cultures arise? They arise around rivers, because rivers make it easy to irrigate your crops. You can dig canals. Well, now, what do rivers occasionally do? They flood and they break their banks. Well, so you do find in a lot of cultures similar flood myths. It's a very common worldwide phenomenon in early primitive cultures. But there's nothing supernatural about it. It's not an evidence for a deity or a worldwide flood. And there are also some ancient cultures that do not have flood myths.
Well, he said that there's microevolution, which shows evolution between kinds, and then there's macro, and that we are taking the big leap of faith.
Microevolution versus macroevolution is sort of a false split. Microevolution is defined basically as whatever we have observed, and macroevolution is whatever we haven't seen yet. If we see an example of what they're thinking is macroevolution, then they'll turn it into microevolution.
But I'm going to let you go, but I want to thank you for calling, and if you like, call us back next week. But do go to talkorigins.org, because I do want to get to at least a couple more callers in our last, well, at least one more caller in our last three minutes. I'm going to try to go to David on one, and because we're limited for time. And your other callers, I'm sorry we missed you, but try calling us back next week. Hello, David?
Hello.
How are you doing?
Well, I'm fine. I'm just enjoying your show. I've just, speaking of evolution, when you look at the study of religion, you can see an evolution in the concept of God and how it's evolved from one level.
You mean different definitions and of God over the years?
It's not a static set something that has been established 5,000 years ago that, has not changed. I mean, it has been an ongoing process of evaluation and reevaluation.
The God of the Old Testament who goes around killing everybody and making war all the time, the God of the New Testament who is apparently a loving and forgiving God.
Right.
And they say that this is the same guy, even though their God is completely unchanging.
Yeah, he's eternal and unchanging, but then he changes at one point. So that's
The whole aspect of the sacrifice that this all-knowing, all-loving God is supposed to have a blood sacrifice so that we can all make it to the high ground.
Yeah, I mean, it's completely crazy. This whole idea underlying Christian theology, which is, there's all these people on Earth, and they're born sinners, and they're doomed to hell, so I'll send this one guy down there, and I'll kill him, and that'll make it okay for everyone else.
Well,
that's ludicrous.
Evolution of the concept of sacrifice.
Yeah, I know. Well, of course, the Christian God, of at least the Judeo-Christian God of the Old Testament, just loved blood and loved sacrifice and loved killing.
It is the war god. The storm god.
The earliest forms
of thing is so prevalent because the storm god, the war god, was this awesome character that if you didn't fear him and worship him, you're going to get your butt kicked. You
That's know? Very true. Anyway, well, we're down to our last minute. Thank you for calling. Got to let you go.
One other little question to throw at you.
Oh, yeah.
Why was the original sin eating from the fruit of knowledge? Why is self-realization somehow...
Because with self-realization, suddenly people might no longer need God. And that's what was upsetting God, apparently, at least according to the old...
That's another psychotic.
Yeah, I know. I agree with you. Hey, come on down to the bagel shop. Talk to us then.
Bye-bye.
Anyway, everyone, well, we got the phones working in the last hour or so of the show.
Barely.
Thanks, everybody, for calling. It's been a great morning. Jeff D. should be back next Sunday. I want to thank Russell for coming back and finishing his presentation on creation science. For me and from the ACA in general, thank you for watching. Christians,
we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Yay.